It's finally arrived, the Crunch Labs final, and in an unusual move, Gucci Reza Firouzja decided to strike a pose by the bathtub on his Twitter. Here he is, over the old Uno cards in the tub. No one's quite sure what that one's all about. Apparently it's all the rage for chess preparation these days. Rather a strange outfit going on there. Is this modern fashion? Jury's still out. Either way, we've got the psycho death stare going down. MVL truly freaked out here as we move into Armageddon. Because the rapid play games were drawn, it's online chess. We move to this format. What does it mean? Well, after e4, e5, these knights developing, look at the clocks on the left-hand side. Alireza's got less time, but he only has to draw to take the victory here. Pressure on MVL, therefore. He goes bishop b5 with a va-va-voom, literally whispers it into the mic. Many top French professionals do that. And now Alireza, what does he do? He plays knight f6. Overpowered opening. Have a listen to Kramnik, who was watching on.
Pooh, what a move.
He knows what a special move this is, and after castles, we're rapidly heading down the main line, because Alireza captures the pawn given. He goes nom nom, as many top professionals do, thanks MVL for giving him the full tummy, and a second pawn is now offered. Has MVL gone nuts? Well, no. If you capture, you open the e-file in a deadly way. So the knight drops back to d6, hits that loose bishop. It takes on c6, shatters the pawns. Of course you always capture towards the center, except when you don't. These grandmasters breaking the rules, even allowing the king now to lose its castling rights. The strong female leads have left the show, can't be a modern Disney, and now h3 gives the king some Lufthansa. Bishop d7, covering the exposed king. There are kids watching this show. Knight c3 played, of course MVL starts stamping his feet, does a little many top guys do when they get the horses into the game, and h6, because obviously b3 played, builds the banana hammock. Is MVL preparing to fianchetto the rook? C pawn to c5. And now rook d1, that's an x-ray you don't want to be a part of. The king slides off the hospital bed, knight d5, and what an octopus. You're dying to play pawn to c ships. Why doesn't it get played? We're gonna see. A5 now on the board. Alireza gaining space. It gets shut down by MVL here, and this is why you didn't want this pawn here. Now there'd be a gaping hole on B6. Very tricky stuff, this pawn structure in the Berlin, and we see it some more with pawn to G5. Good luck keeping up with these clever grandmaster pawn structure moves. Crazy stuff kicking off. C4 now played, the most explosive move, and we get bishop E6. Natural improvement of the piece, and bishop to b2 hits the chocolate slide, but boo, we never saw a fianchetto of the rook. One day we're gonna have to cover some subscriber games where that rook hits the b2 or g2 square. Now knight e7, and this is some cagey maneuvering, right? Way beyond my level, way beyond most people's level. You know, when I clicked and clicked, sometimes this knight's headed to c6 or d4. Very interesting maneuvering could happen, but MVL changes the character of the game with pawn h4, taking a tin opener to Alireza's kingside. He advances with g4, the knight stumbling home. What are you doing back here, says dad. This pawn now supports the other one, and now how about this for an understanding of the pawn structure? MVL plays pawn to f4, just a strange looking move, but the clear idea is to push on here. Very few people understand this. I mean, here's actual footage of a grandmaster watching a beginner player trying to understand the Berlin pawn structures. But we're rattling on. Knight to f5 now played, hopping back, blockading the f-pawn and hitting h4, which can't be defended in any sensible way. So what do we see from MVL? Just an awesome maneuvering. Knight to f1. Dad suddenly proud of this one, because it sets the most deadly trap. if you capture this pawn, well, the idea is that you now maneuver into g3 with the knight, and you're preparing to push f5 soon, not straight away. If the knight hops back to try and block it, then you can take here, bishop captures, and you've opened this deadly chocolate slide. This is the point. Rook has to go. Let me move it over. Thought I had this line prepared. And now you push this pawn down to e7. Bishop's in a world of pain. You know, if you come here, you swap off, and then you make the lady. These are the kind of lines. Amazing stuff. So this is why the pawn is immune. And even if you don't jump back, you just try and wait. White can eventually build up to the f5 break by bringing a rook. Everything like that, and you can bring this one back also. F5 comes eventually, it's unavoidable. So instead, we see rook a6 from Alireza, doesn't take the pawn, keeps the f-pawn blockaded. Now g3 played, supporting the structure. This one finally supported at its base, but it leaves a hole on f3. So an excellent move by Alireza. He jumps into d4. It looks impossible. Can you not just take? Pawn takes, rook takes, well now bishop c5 comes, streaming out with all the matter of fact of the truth, and the rook is dropping off the board. So we jump back, the knight wasn't touched, knight d2 played, covering the important knight jumps, and now we get our favourite, pawn to c6. Kicking the knight backwards, and there's something very sexy about a knight on the third or the sixth on the E and the D file. What a bastion defending the king here. Now we get rook b6, and how many of us are playing rook a3 to cover the pawn? A bit passive. What does MVL do? Rook a to b1, he's on fire here. X-ray defending the pawn, because if you crash through, then the move to play, the sneaky response, is bishop c3. Whoops, this one. And the point is, now of course if you take, there's this deadly pin, you're winning an exchange. If you don't take, well of course there's huge pressure here, a piece is going to drop off the board. So this is the problem, pawn immune. That's why we now see king c7, but it isn't the most precise. Covers the rook, but still bishop c3 is coming. Now you can't play it immediately, or you walk into knight e2 check. Loose bishop dropping off. So MVL gets out of the forking way, covers the e2 square, and now bishop e7 just on the board. Again, if you take, you're running into the same tactics here. Big problems. This is coming with a pin against the king. So we come back. Now bishop e7 played. Those two bishops like oarsmen in a boat, but Alireza rowing slowly down the stream. MVL's in his speedboat here, coming down the Seine, about to crash through on a5, clear out all the poop in readiness for the Olympics, and rook a8 is therefore forced to cover that pawn. Now we get knight e4, and it's such a dominant move. You're preparing now to capture the knight on d4 and win a pawn with the rook. You know, this knight dominates any bishop moves. Also looks at these squares here. And if you try and crash through here, no good. Now you get this f5 break and everything just collapses. This is the really key motif. Bang, remember this one. Kick back the bishop and then everything just floods in. Knight f6 on the way, the rook's lifting. Such a powerful position. Amazing lines. So we come back. That's why the knight held steady on d4, or did it? It jumps back to blockade. There was that threat to actually take it off otherwise. And now you want to take that knight here. It's such a powerful blockader. But then of course the bishop hits onto this diagonal. It's playable, but rook b2, the preferred move of Stockwell, coming off this light squared diagonal, but not played, none of it. Maxime picks up the knight on e3 and completely forgets which direction he's playing in. Je ne comprends pas. All the way back on c2, not ideal, wrong direction MVL, and it suddenly allows Alireza to marshal the troops. The two towers stacked, Tolkien would be proud. Now we get rook d2, MVL going for a two towers of his own, the file challenged, so important when there's just one file on the board that you fight for it, and now after this double stack, we get an exchange, rook recaptures, and Alireza re-entering the game. These clumsy rooks sorted themselves out. B6 can now be played. We get knight e3 coming back, meekly acknowledging the wrong maneuver, and after b6 covering the pawn, b5 also playable, finally we see the exchange which should have happened moves earlier. MVL helping out his French compatriot. Now we see knight d6 hitting the light squares, and if you come back with bishop e6, g6, well, you're running into these f5 tactics. This is the big challenge. So this one best. Now the rook captures back and the bishop comes into e6. Cemento, as Peter Lecko would say, one of the top-notch commentators in the entire world, also an incredible dancer. Very, very few people know about his moves. You can see him strutting his stuff all over Europe many Saturday nights. And now we get the march of the Imperial Monarch. Rook e8 played, and it's such a great move by Alireza. Because if you carry on with king e4, preparing f5, such a natural plan. There's the brilliant shot of pawn f5, and this is a rude awakening. Because if you capture en croissant, looks so natural, you can see Stock Barnacle poops its pants because the rook is simply dropping on d6. So moving back, this one no good. The king's got to give ground, but how about that? You're not breaking this blockade in a month of Sundays. So this is why MVL chucks the f-pawn. It's an excellent move, especially in a must-win game. Because after bishop captures, in marches the king, and fasten your seatbelts because we're jumping into a couple of French speed cars. Can't think of a French speed car right now. I'm pretty stupid on cars, but there must be one. They're both in one, and we've got an absolute race because one player is munching on the queen side, the other is munching on the king side. You could have taken on a4 or c4. Similar thing, really. The pawns are going to rumble. Check was played. King f4, given a miss. Maybe this was more accurate, but okay, this looks so natural. Pawn's now free to run. And after b5 from Alireza, excellent move, by the way, because although he gives this one up with check, white loses time to take it, and you're getting the pawns advancing. He now makes a mistake. Alireza, that is. He should actually play king b7. It allows this rook to then come to d7, d1, h1, and actively stop this pawn advancing. It's deep stuff. I found it with a ton of clicking, right? And I'm still probably wrong, but that's what I gleaned from it. King d7 played, and it's not so good. You support the pieces, come towards the enemy pawns, but the rook now a bit stuck. Maxime goes bishop b6, simply pushing the h-pawn immediately best, apparently. And now this is so weird from Alireza. His c-pawn's under fire. You want to keep that one. It's great on a barbie. Surely push to c4 here, but no. He plays takes on a4, just really overthinking it, splitting his pawns apart, giving white this amazing dark squared grip. His point being rook e8, h5, rook a8 to push this one, red carpet rolled out, but there's a problem. Bishop a3, blockading, and you're in a world of pain. Look at the white pieces, just so much more superiorly placed. Is superiorly a word? Probably not. Rook b8 apparently best to try and activate once more. Think stuff like this, but not played. We get c5 on the board, advancing the c-pawn once more, trying to distract the bishop, then push here, but now it allows h6. The red carpet rolled out like a night at the Oscars. All MVL's got to do now is waltz up and take his face slap from Will Smith. But he's still got a couple steps. Rook h8 from Alireza coming back to blockade. But now this pawn drops with immunity because no more rook behind pushing. So Alireza comes back in a moment. First pushes the bishop. Sometimes you get ahead of yourself in the excitement. Now g4. Now he comes back. King c4 was better, but he is thrashing like a shark in a net. Because after h7, you cannot push this pawn. Simply bishop captures and the rook can't take, or we make a baby girl. So rook h8 forced, but now rook h6, clearing the path for this bad boy to snake its way in. We get king c4, king g5 on the board, race on our hands, but white miles ahead here, and black covering this pawn. Here Alireza resigns the game. Why? He's got to give up his rook to stop that one going through. You can cover, but just for a moment. Here's a sample line. Eventually everything gets mopped up and that's going to run through. You make a bishop, you draw the game. Just kidding. You make something better and you win it. So that's how the game ended in this position here. Congrats to MVL. He takes the whole tournament, knocks out the likes of Magnus and Alireza, Nepo. I was about to say MVL. MVL won it. It's been a long day. Anyway, great performance by him. He's pretty unstoppable when he's in great form. Hope you enjoyed. Do smash subscribe. We've got the Speed Chess Championship kicking off tomorrow. And for another epic game of chess from a 10-year-old prodigy playing Hikaru, check out the video on screen. Thanks a lot for watching and see you soon.